Hey there, college football fans. Appreciate you taking some time out to join me for another installment of The Read Option. I'm Glenn Morgan, and without further ado, let's get to the top 15 in college football. First, we'll check out the AP poll's top 15, and then how I rank the teams. No surprise with the top five teams. Alabama and Oregon appear to be headed for a potential national championship showdown. And clearly, these are the two best teams in the country, so far. Clemson, Ohio State, and Florida State round out the top five. And we'll talk a little bit later on about that huge matchup this coming weekend, October 26th, in Death Valley, as Florida State visits the Tigers of Clemson. Now, our ranked teams at 6 and 7 are LSU and Texas A&M. Both of these teams have one loss, but they're rated higher than the following three teams, which are undefeated. And that's Louisville, UCLA, and the Miami Hurricanes at number 10. On the outside looking in at the top 10 are South Carolina at number 11, followed by Baylor, Stanford, Missouri, and Georgia at number 15. Now, it's iffy if any of these five teams have a puncher's chance of being in the national championship game. But I promise they will make it very interesting down the stretch for those teams above them. All right, that's a look at the Associated Press's top 15 for week 8 in college football. Now, if you've watched the previous installment of this show, you know exactly how I think, and that's way, way outside the box, as was stated by my prediction of Stanford playing Ohio State in the national championship game. Oops. Come on, Buckeyes, make me look good. All right, let's get to my top 15 for this week in college football. Well, as you can see, there's no difference at the top between the AP poll's 5 and my first 5. These are the top teams in the country. Any two of these top 5 could be playing for the national title. My next 5 are slightly different, with LSU at number 6, followed by UCLA, Texas A&M, Miami, and Baylor at number 10. Baylor is probably one of the most underrated teams in college football. They have an offense as dangerous and explosive as any in the land. Sleep on the Bears from Baylor if you want to, but this hyperactive offensive team is far from hibernating for the season. The final 5 reads as shown. At number 11 is Louisville. Now, oddly enough, the Cardinals, for an undefeated team, they look less and less inspiring each week, and they play virtually no competition. They're followed by Texas Tech, next Virginia Tech, and this team is silently but a most deadly team as they creep up the top 15, followed by South Carolina and rounding out with Fresno State. I consider myself a professional observer of sorts, especially when it comes to teams and talent. As such, my Sunday 7 segment highlights those players that should be on the NFL stage playing on Sundays. All right, let's get to this installment's Sunday 7. Dree Archer, senior running back at Kent State. Now, this 5'8", 175-pound athlete already has one 100-yard kick return for a touchdown this year, 13 receptions for 146 yards and 3 touchdowns, along with a 5.5-yard per carry average for rushing. Now, the early part of the season, first 4 games, he's been battling injuries, missing the entirety of 2 games while seeing limited action in 2 others. However, what makes this young man an NFL talent is that this 5'8 dynamo proved last season just how special and unique a player he is. In 2012, he was consensus All-American. He was the MAC Conference's Special Teams Player of the Year. He ran for 1,429 yards along with an insane 9 yards per carry average. You just don't see that, folks. And he also had 16 rushing touchdowns to boot. Plus, you add on the 561 receiving yards, and he caught 4 touchdown passes. And let's not forget, he was the Special Teams Player of the Year because he ran back 3 kickoffs for touchdowns. When healthy, Dree Archer is a hiccup away from scoring. NFL talent waiting to showcase itself on Sundays. Speaking of showcasing, Sports Illustrated showcased in its September 16th issue the lack of ethical control and the rampant abuses within the Oklahoma State football program. Sports Illustrated's 5-part investigative report informed on misgivings regarding sex, drugs, cash payouts, and academic fraud. Ironically, the only thing more shocking than this report was the complete ho-hum reaction by the nation to this story. Been there, done that. It's a month later, and so far, no probationary action has occurred. And by the way, Oklahoma State is 21st in the most current AP poll. If we take a quick look back in history, we'll see that during the 1980s, the now defunct Southwest Football Conference had 6 of its 9 members on probation during that decade. Now, eventually, the conference disbanded due to excessive penalties levied against its members. Pretty much since then, people have come to expect cheating to go hand in hand with big-time athletics. The Southwest Conference began in 1914 and ended officially in 1996. The conference consisted of 9 schools at its peak: Texas, Texas A&M, Texas Tech, TCU, SMU, Baylor, Rice, and Arkansas. The only members to escape probation in the 1980s were Arkansas, Rice, and Baylor. Now, the worst of these disciplinary actions happened in 1987 to SMU, Southern Methodist University. The Mustangs were given the death penalty. Frankly, no football for 2 years. Now, in regards to the SMU case, there were reports of numerous cash payments made to players, academic fraud with test results being altered and plagiarism, female students who were a part of a welcoming committee for potential freshman athletes, and they would use sex as an enticement during the recruiting process. And one story even told of clips being taken from a pornographic movie and edited into game film, and this was explained away as for the edification of the student athletes. The egregious behaviors weren't just done by the athletes and coaches. Oh, sir, even top administrators turned a blind eye toward these abuses. In 1987, for example, the head of SMU's Board of Governors, Bill Clements, who was also governor of the state of Texas, well, initially he denied approving payments to players, but later he admitted his part in the scheme. Asked why he lied, Clements replied, "Well, there wasn't a Bible in the room." Nice. In 1990, Arkansas left for the Southeastern Conference, the SEC. In 1994, Texas, Texas A&M, Baylor, and Texas Tech left to combine with the Big 8 Conference to form what is now called the Big 12. And Oklahoma State was a part of the Big 8 and is now a current member of the Big 12. So all of these things occurred in the Southwest Conference about 20 to 30 years ago. Well, with Oklahoma State's current scandal going on, and that's including their involvement in cash payouts for performance, sham jobs, drug use, sex as a recruiting tool, and just good old-fashioned academic fraud, well, folks, it's nothing new. Since 2002, the Oklahoma State Cowboys have had 10 winning seasons out of the last 11, and currently they're ranked in the top 25. And well, that's worth something, right? Right? Hey, before we end this show, I want to leave you with 2 big games to watch for the Week 8 in college football. Week 8's headliner is Florida State at Clemson, a battle of Heisman quarterbacks. In Florida State, you've got famous Jameis Winston going up against Taj Boyd of Clemson. Whoever wins this game has got an inside track to the Heisman Trophy and puts their team right on the cusp of playing for their national championship. The other game on the left coast that no one's really talking about, people, is UCLA at number 9 against Stanford at 13. Now, Stanford disappointed me by losing to Utah, but I do believe that a Pac-12 team will have something to say about who will be national champion at the end of the year. That's all for this installment of The Read Option. I hope I gave you something to chew on. And if you have a comment about it, leave me a message or hit me up on Twitter. Till next time, catch some college football.